x, y, and z. And then there is one frame that is in arbitrary motion with respect to this other frame. Yeah, so this is x, y, and z here. And this I will call as the O frame of reference. We'll call this as the O star frame of reference here. And this we have called this position vector of the origin of this O frame of reference with respect to the O star frame of reference, we'll call as C of T. And suppose if they are observing the same point, let us say the position, so this is some point in the body, then this position vector we will call as x star. So that is the position vector as observed in the O star frame of reference. And then this position vector we will call as x. And then last time we saw that the relation between these two position vectors, x star, is equal to q of t times x plus c of t, right? Where this q of t belongs to all plus. Q of t belongs to on plus. So it's a proper orthogonal tensor or a rotation. And we saw that the components of this Qij are given by Qij is equal to Ei star dot Ej. Okay, so Ei star dot Ej. So the derivation of this is given in the book. You can take a look at it. But otherwise, you can just accept this particular formula. We will see examples of this, and then maybe this will become clear. So let us look at some examples here. Just one thing to clarify here is that this this change of frame of reference should not be confused with the change of basis in a given frame of reference. Okay, so we have seen this, right? So we have seen, for example, when we were dealing with tensor transformations, right? At that time, we saw that the components of a tensor T bar, so this is, let's say, E1 bar, and this is your E2 bar, this was equal to Q times T times Q transpose. So we saw this particular relation, right? So here we are talking of different coordinate systems in a given frame of reference. Okay, so these matrices Q that occur in this transformation law, they do not depend on time. Okay, because this is just as I said, everything is happening just in one frame of reference, and these are just different coordinate systems, and these are just the components of a tensor with respect to different bases. But here we are talking of two different observers observing a point here, like, and with the position vector given by x star in the O star frame of reference, and the position vector given by x in the O frame of reference, and they are related through this particular relation. So all I'm trying to say is we should not confuse a change of observer with a change of coordinate system within a given frame of reference. Okay, so this, anyway, we will not worry about this particular aspect. We already discussed this in very great detail. Anyway, so just to give some examples of this. So suppose you imagine now that there is some observer who is traveling in a car, and then this suppose is a fixed observer. So this is O star, is a fixed observer. And let us say that this car is moving. Okay, so this is your C of T, right? And so in this particular case, now if you take some position vector x, okay, so then that is just, so now in this particular case, your O frame of reference, so this is your O frame of reference, and the O star frame of reference, they are parallel to each other, and they will remain parallel to each other because this is just translating like this. So in that particular case, your Q of T is just identity. So basically, this Q of T measures the rotation of this particular frame of reference with respect to this particular frame of reference, right? And so here, since this frame of reference is parallel to this one, so here in this particular case, you will get that Q is equal to identity. And so you will get simply that X star is equal to X plus C of T, right? And that we can see, that suppose if you take x is the position vector, and suppose if you take x star as the position vector, then it is just a vectorial sum, right? So x plus c of t will give x star for any point that you are observing, right? So this is a particularly simple case. Now let us take a slightly more complicated case of a spinning disk. So if I now have a spinning disk like this, and
okay,
is EI star dot EJ. Correct? So let us write this Q. So Q is equal to cosine theta minus sine theta 0 sine theta cosine theta 0 0 0 1. So this cosine theta is E1 star dot E1. So that is just cos theta. Then this one is E1 star dot E2. So you go back to this particular. So I am using this particular formula here. E1, so Q12 will be E1 star dot E2. So E1 star dot E2 will be cos of 90 plus theta. So that is minus sine theta. And so on. So that is how we get all the components for Q. Now if you multiply Q times X, right, and add the C, then you will get exactly this particular term here, and these two terms here. So you will get your X star and Y star. So that shows that your X star is Q times X plus C of T. So of course, these are just examples, but basically this works for any change of frame of reference here. Fine. So having introduced now this formula for the position vectors as seen from the two frames of reference. Now we will introduce what is known as a frame indifferent or an objective quantity now. So let us introduce that. Kinematical quantities transform under a frame of reference, okay? Change of frame of reference. So, So let us look at that now. So transformation of kinematical quantities. Transformation of kinematical. So now this particular relation, you will get that chi star of x comma t star is equal to q of t times sin of x comma t plus c of t. This is the relation now between the two motions, and so this relation is going to be very important. So as you can see, actually, this looks like rigid motion, right? So it is not the same as rigid motion actually, because when we are talking about rigid motion, we are talking of the motion of a body, of a rigid body, with respect to one observer or a given frame of reference. But here we are talking of the motion as seen from two different observers. But if you see the mathematical form, they look similar. Okay, so many times this particular equation is also interpreted as a superposed rigid body motion. Okay, so you will see this term many times in the papers and so on, that they call it as a superposed rigid body motion, because as I said, that this equation has the same form like a rigid body motion. But you should understand that we are not talking about rigid motion here. We are talking of the motion of a particular body as seen by two different observers. Okay, so that is the correct picture. But as I said, that because this mathematical form looks like a rigid motion, we sort of give it that interpretation also. So here we will just give it. So this can be given an alternative interpretation. Interpretation of a superposed rigid motion. You can imagine that there is some body. So this is your x is equal to chi of x comma t, and now you imagine that it is now undergoing some rigid motion like this, and it is going to x star, which is equal to chi star of x comma t star, and this motion is this related to this q of chi plus your t. So as I said, that so now this is so this body is actually deforming, but you are superposing one rigid motion on that, and then that is what is observed by the other observer. So you can give it an alternative interpretation of a superposed rigid body motion. But we will not worry out so much about this interpretation, but you will see these terms in technical papers, that superposed rigid motion and things like that. So I thought I will just mention this particular interpretation also. Okay, but the fundamental equation is this. So let me just repeat it. So basically, this is the relation between the motions of a deformed body as seen from two different observers. So this is the motion as seen from the O observer. This is the motion as seen by the O star observer, and they are related through this particular relation here. Fine. Now let us find out what is the relation between the deformation gradients, right? So we know that f is equal to del of chi, right? So that is the gradient of the deformation. And so if we now take the gradient of this one, so that is f star is equal to del of chi star, that is equal to q of t times del of chi with respect to capital X, and so that is going to be q of t times f. Okay. So this is going to be a very, very fundamentally important relation. So basically, for a deforming body as observed by two different observers, the deformation gradient as observed by by the O frame of reference, if the deformation gradient is f, then in the O star frame of reference, the deformation gradient will be observed as q of t times f. Okay, so this so let us just write this particular relation here. So f star is q of t times f. So this is going to be a very, very important relation, which will form the basis for all the relations that are going to follow now. Okay, so from this now we can find out what is the relation between the other kinematical quantities, such as the right Cauchy-Greenstein tensor, the left Cauchy-Greenstein tensor, the Lagrangian measure of strain, the Eulerian measure of strain, the rate rate of deformation tensor, the velocity gradient, and so on and so forth. Okay, so that is what we are going to do now. We are going to derive the transformation rules under a change of observer for all the various kinematical quantities here. Fine. So so C star. So basically, we will use this particular relation. So maybe I'll just write it on the top here, so that we are going to use this relation again and again. So Q of T times N. So this is, as I said, very very important relation here. So C star now. So simply replace. So whatever our relation, suppose C is F transpose F. That is the right Cauchy-Greenstein tensor. So simply replace the F by F star. That's all. So this F star transpose times F. So this will be equal to, now F star is equal to Q times F. So F star transpose will be F transpose Q transpose, and then this should be F star, sorry. And then if you put F transpose Q F, so that will be F transpose F itself. So this will be F transpose F itself. So this is equal to C itself, right? So C star is equal to C. Okay, so you can see that according to that definition, C is not objective, correct? But B star will be objective. B star is equal to F star times F star transpose. So that is equal to Q times F transpose times Q transpose, and that is equal to Q times B times Q transpose. And so this quantity is objective, because as I said, if you recall, T star, and for any tensor T, if T star is Q of T times Q of T transpose, then we say that this particular quantity is objective. So here, this quantity B star, since it transforms as Q times B times Q transpose, it is an objective quantity. But one very important thing here is that, see, for kinematical quantities, we do not impose that a quantity should be objective or not. So whatever comes out of the kinematical transformation, we just go by that. So for example, here, according to our definition, C star is not objective, but that is fine. So because for kinematical relations, it is decided totally by the geometry. And so we don't impose that something should be objective. But later on, when we study dynamical quantities, such as the stress and things like that, we will impose that the stress tensor should be objective. So that means we will impose that the stress tensor, as seen by two different observers, is objective in this particular sense. So this is something which does not follow from any relation, but it is like an axiom that we are going to adopt. Okay, so but as far as kinematical quantities are concerned, the transformation relations for a change of frame of reference is decided totally by the geometry, and so we don't have any choice. If it comes out to be objective, then that is fine. If it doesn't come out to be objective, that's also fine. So as I said, that we do not enforce, or we cannot enforce, that something should be objective or not objective. Whatever comes out of the relation, we simply write it as that. So in that sense, the concept of objective or frame indifference is not so much important when we are dealing with kinematical quantities, because as I said, that we are not imposing objectivity or frame indifference when we are talking of kinematical quantities. So this concept becomes more important when we talk about dynamical quantities such as stress. And so there, we will impose that the stress tensor be objective. And so those parts we will see at a later stage. But at this stage, then let us just continue to derive the various transformation rules for the other kinematical quantities as well. So for the Lagrangian string now, E star, so that is just half of C star minus I. So that is equal to half of C minus I. That is equal to E itself. So E star is equal to E. Then similarly, E bar star, so this is the Almanzi strain, which is the Eulerian measure of strain, that is Q times E bar times Q transpose. So sometimes I may skip the time dependence, that is understood. So Q is always going to be a function of time when I am discussing this topic, but just
sometimes the notation gets very cumbersome, so I may drop the t, but it is understood that this q is always a function of time whenever I am discussing frame indifference, for example here. Fine, then what about the velocity now? And so this is a very very important thing. So we will see now that the velocity is not objective. Okay, so that, and that has very very important implications later on. So let us derive that here. So you will get now that v star is d chi star by dt, right? And then we have seen that this chi star, so let me just rewrite that, chi star is q of t times chi plus c of t, right? So if you differentiate, if you find the material time derivative of this particular relation, you will get that q of t times d chi by dt plus q dot of chi plus c dot. Okay, so this is the relation that we get, and now d chi by dt is nothing but the velocity itself. So this with respect to the O frame of reference. So this is equal to q of t times v plus q dot times x plus c dot. Okay. So you can see now that the velocity vector is not objective. Right. So suppose if v star had been q of t times v, then it would have been objective. But there are these additional terms that are sitting here, and so the velocity vector is not an objective quantity. As I said, all this will have very important implications later on. But physically, how do we understand this particular result? So see, if a vector is objective, then its norm is going to be the same, right? Because it's an orthogonal transformation. So the magnitude of v star will be the same as the magnitude of v if a particular vector is objective. But here, as I said, the velocity vector as observed by two different observers will not have the same magnitude. So this is physically, it is very easy to understand this. So imagine that suppose you are in a car, okay, and suppose if there is a stationary observer. Now, so imagine that there are two people sitting in the car. So with respect to one person, okay, who is the driver, let us say, with respect to the driver, his passenger is stationary, correct? Because let us say that he is not moving with respect to the car. So the velocity of the passenger with respect to the driver is zero. But this whole car is now traveling like this, right? So the velocity of that same passenger with respect to a stationary observer is going to be the velocity of the car itself, correct? So clearly, so one person is observing the velocity of the passenger as zero, the other observer is observing it as the velocity of the car itself. So clearly these two magnitudes are not the same, right? One is a zero vector and the other is a non-zero vector, right? And so clearly the magnitude of these two vectors is not going to be the same, right? So if it had been objective, then the magnitude would have been the same. So as I said, that even physically it is very clear that the velocity vector is not objective. Fine. And then similar thing happens even for the acceleration also. So the same example, you can see that suppose if this car is accelerating, so with respect to the driver, the passenger has zero acceleration, but with respect to a stationary observer, this person will have some acceleration, right? And so again, acceleration is also a non-objective quantity, and that will also come out of this analysis. So if I now differentiate this once more, then I will get the relation for the acceleration also. So let us do that. So let us look at the acceleration now. So this A star will be equal to q times A plus 2 times q dot times v plus q double dot times x plus c double dot. Okay. So basically take the material time derivative, second material time derivative of this, you will see that you will get a q dot times v, okay, and then there will be a q dot v from this relation also. So that is why you get a 2 q dot v, and then you will get q times acceleration, so that is this one,
and then the derivative of this one, that will be theta beta. So because of these terms now, you can see that it is not objective. So again, physically I have already explained, but you can see that suppose if these terms had not been there, then the acceleration vector would have been objective. But because these terms are there, the acceleration is also not an objective quantity here. Fine. Then what about the velocity gradient now? So L star, so we have already seen this relation that f dot is A equal to L times F, right? With this relation. So this f dot is nothing but df by dt, right? We have seen this particular relation. So the material derivative of the deformation gradient is the velocity gradient times the deformation gradient. And from this particular relation, I know that L should be equal to f dot f inverse. So that is just because f is always invertible, the det f, the orientation preserving condition is that det f should be greater than 0. And so you will get that L is equal to f dot f inverse. And then, so let us write now L star. So that is equal to d of f star by dt times f star inverse. So wherever, you know, whatever is our relation, we simply replace it by a star, right? So L star will be f dot star times f star inverse, right? So that just put star, wherever there is no star, you just put star, that is how we get the particular quantity with respect to the O star frame of reference. And so df star by dt, as I said, that is just going to be, this relation I actually erased. So f star is equal to q of t times f. So from this relation, you will get df star by dt as q times df by dt plus q dot times f and times f inverse times q transpose. Okay. And so if you simplify this, now you will get that L star is equal to q times L times q transpose plus q dot q transpose. Okay, so this is now the relation for the, so this is the relation for the transformation of the velocity gradient with respect to two different observers here. Okay, then we take the symmetric part of this, then we will get how the rate of deformation tensor transforms under a change of observer. So you will get that d star is equal to half of L star plus L star transpose, that is going to be equal to q times d times q transpose, because q dot q transpose belongs to skew, right? This is part of the homework. So so you can see that this is an objective quantity. So this is frame indifferent or objective, frame indifferent or objective. And this will also have a very important implication at a later stage, right? So then W tilde star is half of L star minus L star transpose, that is equal to Q times W tilde times Q transpose plus Q dot Q transpose. So again, because of this additional term, the vorticity tensor is not objective, right? So, okay. So as I said, but we don't care. I mean, for kinematical quantities, okay, if it is objective, fine. If it is not objective, that is also fine. All right. So, okay. Then what about del dot b? So del dot b is simply the trace of L. So let us derive that particular relation here. So del dot v, so del of with respect to x star dot v star, that is equal to trace of L star. So now the trace of q dot q transpose will be 0, because it's a skew symmetric tensor and trace is a linear operator. So it is trace of L star will be trace of q L q transpose plus trace of q dot q transpose. So but trace of q dot q transpose will be equal to 0. and trace of Q and Q transpose will be the same as trace of L, because the principal invariants are all the same under an orthogonal transformation. Right, so this is going to be equal to trace of L itself, so trace of L, and so that is equal to del of V. So del X star dot V star is equal to del dot V with respect to a small x here. Fine. So what about dV star by dV? So so we have already seen that E star is equal to E, and so we get that dE star by dT is equal to dE by dT. See, actually here I did not talk about the transformation rule for the time. So this actually, so you can just imagine that the clocks are set differently. But see, so even if the clocks are set differently, when you take the time derivative, that time derivative is going to be the same, right? Because derivative with respect to derivative of T star with respect to T is simply one. And so so basically, actually this plus A, we have taken it, this A as non-zero, but for all practical purposes, you can take it to be zero also. That means the clocks are set to be the same, because that does not make much difference, you know, as far as this objectivity is concerned. I think the more important part is the X star is equal to Q of T times X plus C of T. So that is what actually makes a difference. So so even if you assume that T star is T, that does not make much much of a difference, because so in that sense I'm just writing it in this particular way. So actually I should write T star here, but as I said, B with respect to any T star is also the same as D with respect to T itself, and so you get this particular equation here. Fine. Then the last thing is the material time derivative of E bar. Yes, so D of E bar star by dT is equal to D star minus L star transpose times E bar star minus E bar star times L star. So this you can just get from the relation that basically link E bar to E, and then you will get this particular relation here. And from this, you will get that this is Q times dE bar by dT times Q transpose plus Q dot times E bar times Q transpose plus Q times E bar times Q dot transpose. And so because of these additional terms, again, the material time derivative of E bar is not objective. And so actually this has an important lesson in it, that E bar we saw was objective, but its material time derivative is not objective. And so again, at a later stage, this will have implications when we talk of the material derivative of the stress tensor. Okay, so at that time, we'll see that this has implications at that particular time. Okay, so now let us move on to the next principle, which is principle of frame indifference. And so this is again going to be a very, very important principle. So let us discuss that and, in very great detail now. So balance laws have the same form in all frames of reference. Okay, so this is a very, very fundamental principle that we are going to follow in all the, I mean, throughout this book. So balance, laws, have the same form in all frames of reference. Okay, so this is, as I said, a very, very fundamental statement. So actually, this viewpoint is not followed by most of the other authors, especially when it comes to balance of linear momentum. So their inertial frame, so that is sort of a fixed frame of reference, and the laws, the balance of linear momentum, is written with respect to the inertial observer, and that is considered as a fundamental statement. And then the statement for a non-inertial observer is derived from this more fundamental equation that is written out for an inertial frame of reference. So, so the balance law for balance of linear momentum statement comes out to be different for an inertial observer, and then you have to add certain additional terms like the Coriolis acceleration or centripetal acceleration and things like that, and then you get the balance of linear momentum for a non-inertial observer, so to speak. But here, so I am actually not going to follow that viewpoint. So this is the viewpoint that we are going to follow, that the balance laws have the same form in all frames of reference. So basically, with this viewpoint, we will not have a special frame of reference such as the inertial frame of reference. So there is no preferred frame of reference in this viewpoint. So basically, any two observers are equally qualified to observe a particular phenomenon, and both these observers will be treated on an equal footing. So now we are talking of two different observers who are in arbitrary motion with respect to each other, and each will have the same form of the balance law for both of them. Okay, so that is the fundamental shift in terms of the viewpoint that we are using. So first let us start by looking at the implications of this particular viewpoint. So let us start with the balance of mass first. So let us apply this principle to balance of mass first. So balance of mass. Okay. We have seen that the balance of mass can be written as d rho by dt plus rho times del dot v is equal to 0. Okay? So this is the. So now we adopt the viewpoint that basically this has the same form in any other frame of reference. So that means d rho star by dt plus rho star del x star dot v star, so this is with respect to x, is equal to 0. So this is what we mean by the same form. That means it looks exactly the same. Whatever are the unstar quantities, they get replaced with the star quantities. So that is what we mean by this. So now let us see whether this statement holds, right? So rho star is a density, right? And it's a physical variable. So we postulate that the same density is observed by both the observers, right? So because it's a scalar variable, so basically we postulate that rho star of x star comma t star is equal to rho of x comma t. This is what we postulate, and so this is something that we will postulate for all scalar physical variables, right? That day, basically the same scalar physical variable is observed by both the observers. So another example that I will give is temperature, for example, right? So when we look at temperature, we will say that the temperature as observed by one observer will be exactly the same as the temperature observed by another observer. Of course, at a given point. So we are talking of the temperature at a given point as observed by two different observers, that is going to be the same. So that is a postulate that we will make as far as scalar physical variables are concerned. So you have to be very careful here. So suppose if you are talking of an artificially created scalar variable, for example, the kinetic energy, right? In that case, so let us just call it as half of v star dot v star, okay? With a rho, let us say, or rho star. But let's not worry about the rho star, because the rho star is the same as rho. So essentially this. So now this is not going to be equal to half of rho times b dot. Correct? That is because we have seen that the magnitude of b star is not the same as the magnitude of b. Correct? So when I am talking of kinetic energy, then that is a scalar variable, but that is not objective. Or that is not going to be the same as observed by two different observers, because that is just an artificial construct. It's, the kinetic energy is not a physical variable, right? As observed. So when I talk about physical variables, physical scalar value variables, we will impose that they are objective. But when I talk of artificially constructed scalar variables, they need not be objective. Yeah? So here, as I said, we do not impose it. So coming back to this particular thing, the rho star is the same as rho because of whatever we just discussed here. And then we have also seen that del x star dot v star is the same as del x dot v. So this we have already proved when we were doing the transformation for the various kinematic quantities. So this is equal to del x dot v. Right? So this we have already seen. And so you will see that if this relation holds, then this relation holds. If this holds, then this holds. And so you can see that they have the same form in all frames of reference. So trivially, this mass conservation equation has the same form in all frames of reference. By trivially, I mean that there is no new relation that falls out by adopting the fact that they have the same form. They have the same form in all frames of reference. So when we talk about the balance of linear momentum, we will see that there are some implications of adopting this particular principle, so as we will see now. Fine. Okay. Let us look at the other thing here. So that is the balance of linear momentum now. Yes. So now let us look at the balance of linear momentum. So we are going to apply this principle of frame indifference to now the balance of linear momentum. So let us look at that now. So this, before we do that, we will now postulate that the traction vector is frame indifferent. Huh? So traction vector is frame indifferent. This is what I was saying, that this is now a postulate. This is now a postulate or an axiom that we are going to adopt. This is not something that we can prove, okay? But as I said, that how do we finally verify whether an axiom is true? So we will look at the consequences of that axiom, and if they agree with physical experience, then we adopt that axiom, right? And also, there are certain physical considerations by which we can say that this is a reasonable axiom to adopt. So let us go back now to the spinning disc example. Right? So let us go back to that. So this is the spinning disc, and then there is this spring, and then there is this block which is mounted on this rotating disc here. Now, as the disc starts rotating, now this block that deforms by some distance delta, right? We have seen that. So the deformation. So initially the block was at this particular position, and now once the disc starts rotating with some angular velocity omega, it goes, it displaces by this distance delta. Let us imagine that the force, the spring constant, is A. Let us say, okay. Now you can see that the deflection of this spring, as seen by the O star observer, who is the stationary observer, is also going to be delta, correct? So because it is just the distance that the block is moving, and the spring constant is also k, and hence you can see that the force that is exerted on the block by the spring is going to be K delta, correct? So this force is going to be the same whether it is observed by the O star observer or also by the O observer, right? Because even the O observer is also observing the deflection as delta, and this O star observer is also observing it as delta. The only thing is that this force is observed as an inclined force by the O star observer, whereas in the O frame of reference, it is observed along this particular coordinate axis or along the groove. But for this observer, it will be observed in some inclined position. So basically, the same traction is observed by both the O star and the O observers, except that one is a rotated version of another. So that is exactly what we mean by objective. And so we will postulate that the traction vector is frame indifferent or objective. So let us just draw that particular picture here. So suppose if this is n star, correct, which is equal to q times n, and then your t star will be equal to q of t times p. So this is the postulate that we will make. So under this superposed rigid body motion, your n is this, and so this is just a rotated version of that, and then similarly your t is rotated to give this t star, which is q of t times t. So basically, this is the axiom that we are going to adopt, that the traction vector as observed on a given plane is the same. Modular rotation, it is the same as observed by the two different. So basically, if one observes the traction as t, the other simply observes it at the rotated one. And this q is exactly the same as the q in the x star is equal to q of t times x plus c of t, right? So this q is the same here. And so that is what we are now postulating here. Okay, so let me just write this whole thing a little bit more clearly. So t star of x star comma t star comma n star is equal to q of t times p of x t n. So this is the relation between the traction vectors as observed by the two different observers here. Fine. Then now let us see what is the implication of this for the stress tensor. Right? So T star is nothing but tau star times n star, correct? And then here this is equal to q of t times tau times n. But n star is nothing but q times n. So that is because, see, n star you can think of as x2 star minus x1 star. It's like a difference between the position vectors of two different points. And then x2 star minus x1 star will be q of t times x1 minus x2 from this particular relation. And so you will get n star is equal to q times n. So here let me write this. So tau star times q of t times n is equal to q of t times tau times n. And this is valid for all n, because you can choose any point on the body, and so any normal basically, and so this is valid for all n. And then because of equality of tensors, you will get that tau star times q is equal to q times tau, and so you will get that tau star of x star comma t star is equal to q of t times tau of x comma t times q of t transpose. So this is the relation between the stress tensors as observed by two different observers. Okay, so basically, once we adopt the axiom that the traction is frame indifferent, then automatically the stress also becomes frame indifferent. But you have to remember that this is an axiom, or axiom in the sense it's a postulate that we are making, you cannot prove this postulate. It's a it's based on physical considerations, like this particular example, right? So based on this physical experience, we postulate that this is true. And then, as I said, that we will see what are the implications of this particular postulate. And if they agree with experience, then we adopt that postulate, right? And otherwise, we go back and say, okay, something may be wrong in our postulate because the results are not matching with our experience or with experiments. Then we go back and change that postulate. But in this case, you will see that this postulate is a very reasonable postulate to make after we see what are the effects of adopting this particular postulate here. Fine. So now, let me write this relation here again on the top because we are going to use this again and again. Tau star of x star dot t star is equal to q of t times tau of x dot t times q of t transpose, right? So this is the relation now. Let us see now what are the implications of this particular relation. So if you recall the equilibrium equation or the balance of linear momentum equation is del x dot k plus rho times b is equal to rho times d by dt. Right? So this is our law. And so we need to compute this divergence now of the stress tensor and see how that transforms. So what we will see is that del dot k is a vector, right? And so you will see that that vector is also an objective vector. So that is what now we will show. So let us write the del x star dot tau star the I component. Okay, so that is equal to del tau ij star by del xj star. Okay, and this is equal to q times ir q times js times del tau rs by del xj star. So all I have done is I have written this in initial notation. So the q, they do not depend on the position vector. They are functions simply of time, right? So when I am differentiating with respect to x star, then only this tau gets differentiated, but the other things just come outside the partial derivative sign here. And now use the chain rule here. Yeah? So this is equal to q I r q j s del tau rs by del xm times qjm. So this qjm comes because, see, once we write x star is equal to q times x plus c, I can write x as q transpose times x, x star minus c. So I can write it in this particular way. And so when I differentiate this x, let's say in this particular case it is del tau rs by del xm, and this is del xm by del xj star. This is actually del xm by del xj star. Okay. And so that will turn out to be qjm. Okay, so by this particular relation here. And now you can combine these two. So you can see this qjs times qjm is like q transpose q, right? The sm component of this. So let me write that. So this is equal to qir times delta ms times del tau rs by del xm. Correct? So that is, as I said, here I'm using the relation that qjs qjm is delta sm. Right? Q transpose q is identity tensor. So I'm just using that. Then use the substitution operator property for this. So this is equal to qir times del tau rs by del xs. And that is equal to the cube times del dot tau the ith component of I. Okay, so that is just the ith component of q times del dot tau. So basically what they have shown now is that del dot tau star is q times del dot tau. So we'll write that here. So let us write this particular relation. This is very, very important. Del x star dot tau star is equal to q times del dot tau. Okay, so this is, as I said, very, very fundamental relation here. Fine. Okay, so now we are ready to see the implication of this Freeman difference for the balance of linear momentum. Right? So so let us write that. So if I write rho times A is equal to del dot tau plus rho times B. Right? So this is the form of the balance of linear momentum in one frame of reference. And then the so we are adopting the principle that the balance laws looks the same, right? In all frames of reference. So let me just rewrite this. So I write this as rho times A minus B is equal to del dot tau. Okay, and so so the principle in the other frame of reference will look like this. A star is equal to del x star dot tau. Right, that's what we will get. And so this here is nothing but q times del dot tau. So this is q times del dot tau, and so if I multiply now this, so we also know that rho star and rho are the same, right? We know that rho star is equal to rho, and so if I multiply this whole equation by q, then you will see that the right hand sides are going to be the same for this particular relation and for this particular relation. Hence, the left hand sides also have to be the same. So basically, what we will get is that, so let me just write it in a slightly different way, B star minus A star is equal to Q times B minus A. This is the fundamental relation that we will get out of adopting the axiom that the balance of linear momentum looks the same in all frames of reference here. Okay, so basically, what we have seen is that the acceleration vector is not objective, correct? That we have already seen. But now, what we are saying is that because of adopting this principle of frame indifference, the difference between the body force and the acceleration is an objective quantity. So B star minus A star is Q times B minus A. That means the same magnitude of B minus A will be observed by both the observer. So actually, I mean, even physically, let us imagine. So let us see what the implication of this principle is. So physically, suppose if you are in a falling lift, okay, in a freely falling lift, then actually your body force is that of gravity, and your acceleration is also gravity, and hence your B minus A is zero. Now you imagine that you are in outer space where there is no gravity and your acceleration is zero. So in that particular case also, you have that the B star minus A star there is also zero. So basically what I'm saying is that you will not be able to distinguish whether you are in a freely falling lift or in outer space. Because in both cases, you will experience this weightlessness, right? So if you're in a freely falling lift, your B, actually the body force is that of gravity, and your acceleration is also that of gravity, and hence the B minus A is zero. And if you're in outer space, then there is no gravity and you're stationary. So then there also, so basically there is nothing. So if you're in a freely falling lift, you will not be able to figure out whether you are actually in the freely falling lift or in outer space. Okay, so that is sort of the implication of this statement, this mathematical statement here. There is no experiment by which you can know that unless you look outside. So if there is a window on the left, then you will see, okay, I'm falling with that is with respect to some stationary object, and then you see, okay, you are really falling. But otherwise, suppose if it is just a closed lift, you will not be able to figure out whether you are in outer space or in a freely falling lift. So this is sort of the implication of this particular principle. And so out of this now, what we will get is that the body force is not now an objective quantity. Okay, so let me just write that here. So what we will get now is the following. Yes, so what we will get now is that the body force V star is equal to Q times V minus Q times A plus A star. Right? And so because of these additional terms, the body force is now no longer an objective quantity. So we will see the implications of this, but before we do that, let me contrast this viewpoint that I have adopted here with the classical viewpoint. Okay, so the classical viewpoint is the following, right? That there is an inertial. So this is the classical viewpoint. This is the classical viewpoint. And this is the viewpoint that I am adopting. So we have current viewpoint or in the sense whatever I am adopting here. So in this, there is an inertial frame of reference, right? Inertial frame of reference. Here, I am saying that all frames of reference are equivalent. So all frames are equivalent. And so here, in the classical viewpoint, the inertial frame has a special status. Correct. So that is when actually we write the balance of linear momentum in an inertial frame first, because so the balance of linear momentum is valid first in an inertial frame, and then the non-inertial version is derived using this inertial frame of reference here. So this is a special, so let me put that here. So special, this is a special frame of reference, okay? It has a very special status. So this is inertial means it is at rest, absolute rest. Actually there is nothing that is at absolute rest in the entire universe, but we have to imagine that there is some such inertial frame. So in the current viewpoint, there is no special frame. No special frame, because all frames of reference are considered to be completely equivalent to each other. Then here in the classical viewpoint, we will say that the body force is objective, active. Okay. Whereas so basically in this viewpoint, you say that the magnitude of the body forces are the same with respect to all frames of reference. But in this particular viewpoint that I am adopting, we have already seen that it is not objective, right? So here, let me put it here. So this is objective, body force is objective. But here, in this viewpoint, you have that V star is equal to QB minus QA plus A star. So this is non-objective, right? Non-objective. And then in this viewpoint, the balance laws look different in the two frames of reference. So here, the balance laws in inertial and non-inertial are different. Non-inertial look different. So to be very specific, you will have terms like the centripetal acceleration or the Coriolis acceleration. All those terms will get added to the inertial form of the balance of linear momentum. So in this particular viewpoint, whatever the current viewpoint, balance laws look the same. So balance laws look the same in all frames of reference. So you can see that the two viewpoints are different. But finally, what you have to realize is that the answers will finally be the same. So if you are solving a particular problem, the answers that come out of this viewpoint will be exactly the same as the answers that. So we are not claiming that the answers are going to be different, but the way you are looking at things is completely different in these two viewpoints. So for me, this is a much more rational viewpoint.
But unfortunately, this viewpoint is not followed in any of the continuum mechanics books actually, except maybe one or two books, but I don't know, not very sure. But very few, I mean, almost nobody follows this particular viewpoint. But in the next class, we will show that actually the implications of adopting this particular viewpoint are consistent with physical experience. Okay, so that is something that we will see in the following class. But basically here, so you can see that here you are having a different form of the balance loss, but the B star is objective. Here the balance loss is the same, but the B star is not objective. So they sort of compensate each other. Okay, and then finally, as I said, the answers are the same. But in this viewpoint, you know, there are a lot of contradictions. I mean, if you read all your CBSE books or your Feynman or Resnick and Halliday, they will have all kinds of terms like centrifugal is a pseudo force or things like that. You know, this pseudo means something that is not real. But actually, if you sit on a spinning disc, you will feel an outward force, right? That is very, 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 very evident that you feel all these forces. So to call them pseudo actually does not make much sense, right? And so we will see in the next class that if you adopt this particular viewpoint, you will actually get a real centrifugal force with this particular viewpoint. So that is an outward pointing force. So that I will demonstrate in the next class. So that is what I said, that first of all, the fact that we don't have to follow, don't have to adopt a special frame of reference, and the fact that all frames of reference are equivalent is itself more logical than adopting one special frame and then trying to derive other frames from that. So that is the first thing. And then the second thing is that the body force that comes out of this particular viewpoint will be consistent with physical experience. So that is the reason that I prefer this particular viewpoint, which, as I said, is quite different than the one that is adopted in most of the continuum mechanics books. But we will discuss these things in greater detail in the following class.